Well, good morning. It's always nice to say good morning on a sunny day and not on a cloudy, rainy one. Welcome to Buckie Baptist Church, for those of you who are regulars, who are members, and for those of you who are visiting for the first, second, or 50th time, you are more than welcome. If God is our Father, we, his children, then are brothers and sisters. And that means that you are sitting in family. Now, I appreciate for some folk the concept of a family gathering on a Sunday may just be the thing that tips you over the edge. But this is a nice family, and we're not going to complain whether you take the extra bit of chicken or not afterwards. So please feel free to relax and to focus on God, which is our purpose this morning. To come before the God of all creation, our Father, and worship him and enjoy his company.
Right.
Father God, we come before you this morning aware of the busy week that we've had, aware of the discussions we've had with people, the chats, the meetings, aware of our plans for the coming week, aware of the need to get home, cook lunch, travel. But Father, right now, we want to sit at your feet. Maybe just lean our head against your knee and listen to your voice speaking to us. To rest in your presence. To be overwhelmed with the love and the peace that you have. We thank you that you have given us this gift, and it exists because of what Jesus did. The gift of being able to walk into your presence and sit and rest. Father, may we be Christ's ambassadors this coming week. May we be fully reconciled with you and able to tell others about that. That is our hope, that is our wish, that is what we want, our heart's desire, to be your people. But as we come now to focus on this time together, we ask for your peace and your stillness, and that our ears would be open to hear you. For we ask this in your name. Amen.
And Jesus said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable shall we use for it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which, when sown on the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet, when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants, and puts out large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. And now, we are the evidence of this great truth. The living branches of God's kingdom, redeemed by the power of the cross. We've been grafted into his family, adopted as sons, and commissioned as saints. Therefore we go, proclaiming the King and his coming kingdom, empowered by the Spirit. We are sent to sow the seed of the gospel among every tribe, tongue, language, and people. What a mighty God we serve, ruler of heaven and earth, worthy of our every word, every thought, every breath. We exist to make his name known. He is our Father, undying in love. He is our Lord, our Redeemer, our King. He is enthroned forever. By the work of Christ alone, we are united in him, heirs of the kingdom of God, reminded by the humblest of seeds."
To start our service this morning, I want to read from second letter to the Corinthians. Chapter 5 and verse 16, just to the end of the chapter, not the end of the book, don't worry. "So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though once we regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are, therefore, Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
Heaven.
The presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Come bow before him now with reverence and fear. In him the sin is found, we stand of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He burns with holy fire, with
so I'm aware that obviously after convention, those of you who have been here during the week, you are fired up and ready to go. Those who are here just on a Sunday, it's all available on the website so you can catch up. And I'm also painfully aware that you're probably used to, you know, sort of high level preaching, and now you've got me. So we'll work through this together. But I wanted to look at the idea of renewal, and focusing in on part of the verse that we read there. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here. And I find myself, as I was preparing this sermon, I find myself getting, I don't know if angry was the word, or frustrated, but I'm just becoming aware that in recent weeks and months, there's been various actions covered in the media that have been committed by Christians, and I'm using the air quotes deliberately, despite the fact there is little evidence of Jesus. there's an awful lot being done by Christians who are not actually dealing with Jesus, at least publicly. Now, by and large, and I don't want to put a bias on this, by and large, a number of these actions are being conducted by our cousins across the water in America. And there is an element of, oh, well, that doesn't matter. Every year, as an English teacher, I am faced with children who want to write essays about the death penalty. And my response is, it doesn't matter. From an SQA point of view, they're not going to really worry about your ability to discuss the death penalty in a country that isn't ours. It has to be relevant to Scotland. But the problem is that I have is that when the media picks up on what Christians do, then other people see me in that light. And that's where I was getting a bit niggled this week. There's a lady in Arkansas whose husband is a Republican politician who has taken it upon herself to decide what is good and right for other people to read. So the town she's in has little community libraries. Now, we have them in places in Britain as well where you've got a disused phone box that the community has stocked with books. And you can go and borrow them and put them back, and you quite often they're in holiday destinations, so the books you bought for holiday can go in there. And she has decided to remove every book that she doesn't think is right and then replace it with Bibles that she's bought in some second-hand shop. Now, don't get me wrong, I appreciate that what she's doing. What niggles me is that without any consultation with anybody else, she has decided that Jesus has told her that book isn't for to be read. I have a problem with that. I have a problem with school districts in Florida who have decided that because in the name of Christianity, they're not going to teach the whole text of Romeo and Juliet anymore because it's too racy for children. I would argue that both the school districts in Florida and that quaint little old lady in Arkansas have never read Song of Songs or vast tracts of the battles that go on in the Old Testament, both of which really should have at least a 12 age limit on them, and certainly in the 50-odd years that I've been on the planet, I've yet to have a preacher stand up and give me a whole sermon about Song of Songs. Anybody heard a sermon on Song of Songs? One, two, three, excellent. So four, yeah, we have a few, excellent. It's not often covered, but we can't teach Shakespeare because it's too racy. Now, maybe these are funny and sad, but actually there's an underlying element to this. The editor of the US version of Christianity Today was talking recently to Newsweek and commenting that he is hearing increasingly from conservative pastors that they are being told that Jesus is too liberal. That when they have stood up as pastors and preached, particularly the example that was given was preaching the Sermon on the Mount, congregation came up to the pastor and said, "Where are you getting these liberal ideas from?" And the pastor was like, "I am literally quoting the words of Jesus. They're too woke, they don't work anymore." That is where we are beginning to have that problem. We're losing the focus on Jesus, and people are beginning to take... Now, it's not new. It's just not a new thing. I think probably once every generation we have to remind ourselves that Jesus is actually the focus. But conversations that start off with, "Well, in my church, we do," or "in my version of worship," really need to be held off, and we need to think, hang on, remember those bracelets that we all had in the 80s that said, "What would Jesus do?" That's where we need to be, going back to that and saying, what is Jesus after? Not what is my church after, or what my particular denomination think. What would Jesus be asking? And it was presumably because some computer algorithm picked up what I was reading, the quote from Gandhi popped up on my feed at some point this week. Gandhi commenting, "I like your Christ, but I don't like your Christians." Now, there was a historical element. The way that Christianity had been forced into India had not appealed to everyone. But the fact that he liked Christ, the actual person of Jesus, not the way it was practiced. And that's where this idea of renewal, that we need to remind ourselves constantly that the old has gone. The new that is Jesus, if Jesus is living in us, it's got to be him that people see. But there are things, I think, that keep us, that keep us from Jesus. Bits of paper. A couple of weeks ago, a celebrity who shall remain nameless, but I will go as far as to say that very recently a court-appointed judge has told this celebrity to keep their fingers off their Twitter feed and stop commenting on other people, was asked to describe their faith journey. It was a public meeting, and they were asked to describe their faith journey and talk about those who had mentored them. Now, when you undo the Christian code in there, that says, talk about your relationship with God. Now, for me, raised in a non-evangelical Church of Scotland, that's an incredibly personal question, and I struggle to answer these questions when people throw them at me, because my basic programming is that my faith is personal, and thank you. Over the years of working in and being part of evangelical churches, I've kind of relaxed a little, but that's still my basic programming. But this particular celebrity didn't shrink at the question. In fact, they went for it full on. Oh, they had an answer. The first part of the question, they responded by saying that their life had been fantastic before they took a new job. God wasn't mentioned in that. And the new job was apparently a bit of a problem. Now, things that are related to that new job plague their life. There was no mention of coming to a faith. The second part of their answer, they mentioned religion and noted that they had really good friends who had good lives because of religion. You were asked to describe your journey, your faith, and you're ending up talking about people who have a good life because of their religion. And the third thing our celeb noted was that they knew lots of people across the whole religious spectrum, not just Christians, and that these were the finest people. The question was, describe your journey with God. Describe your faith, your relationship with God. And the answer was, I had a good life before I changed job. I know some folk who are doing very well because of their religion. And I know lots of people across lots of religions. Complete avoidance of the question. But it actually ties in with what keeps us from listening to Jesus, even as Christians, perhaps especially as Christians. It's pride in ourselves. Am I still alive, Alan? Is it still going on? I seem to have lost an echo there. Am I okay? Yep, good. It's pride, and perhaps pride in ourselves. It's a false sense of security. What is giving us our security? What's making us feel okay? And it's a misunderstanding of what righteousness actually is. And these are things that I think can slip into a Christian's life. We do know the answers, but we sometimes glide a little. Pride is a great thing. I am intensely proud of my children. I'm not even going to talk about exam results. I am intensely proud of my children, and that is a good thing. But when we get intensely proud of ourselves and our achievements, it can get in the road of how we deal with other people. When we are sitting there going, I'm doing the best thing, I had a wonderful life before something happened, then actually gets in the road of our ability to see the needs of other people. Our sense of security is essential. We need to feel secure to get over our anxieties, to deal with the fears that we have. But if our security is only in ourselves and in what we know, then that can be quite shaky. Our celeb was quite convinced he had absolute security because he knew some people had good lives. We can begin to feel secure in our lives, not in Jesus. And as a sense of righteousness, a sense of righteousness is where we get our rights and our wrongs from. It's how we understand what is right behavior, what is good behavior, and what is utterly, utterly wrong. If we are so full of self-pride and our sense of any kind of security is rooted in ourselves, then our sense of righteousness will wander off and we will have the wrong guiding compass. And this happens to Christians as well as to non-Christians. We are, we drift and we sometimes will do things and our sense of righteousness will be skewed. The celebrity I've mentioned felt that because they knew people from all over the religious spectrum, lots of different religions, that gave them a sense of what was right. But also have a sense of, a moral guidance that is just vague. And that's not helpful. So to illustrate these type of points, I want to look at three characters from the New Testament. You knew there was going to be a three coming in there at some point, didn't you? You're waiting for it. We could issue a wee, 3-point note page for you. I want to look at the chap entitled The Rich Young Man, The Woman at the Well, and the guy who gets the glorious title of The Good Thief. And I just want to look at those three characters. So, first one is Mark chapter 10. If you have your Bibles or your phones, you can have a check. Mark chapter 10, and I want to look at verses 17 through 25. The Rich Young Man is the title given to this section. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for the rich man to enter the kingdom of God." So, picture the scene. Jesus and his disciples are walking along, talking, laughing, discussing what's happened in the last wee bit. Immediately before was where people were bringing children to Jesus and the disciples were trying to block them and Jesus was like, no, you bring the kids in. And then this man rushes up, perhaps even pushes his way to the front. Is he desperate to have the truth told to him or does he just feel that he should be at the front because he's got jingly coins in his pocket? I don't know. But he gets himself to the front and it manages to get on his knees and then speaks directly to Jesus and said, "Look, what do I need to do? What's the story?" And perhaps in his pride, he was waiting for a sort of attaboy. Jesus is saying, "Listen, you've heard the commandments. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. Love your mom and dad. Got it? I've done all that. I'm a good boy." And maybe he was waiting for Jesus. Maybe other rabbis had done this. Maybe he'd been asking this of other rabbis, and other rabbis had gone, you've kept the commandments. Good lad, well done. Oh, he feels good about himself now. And he picked the wrong rabbi this day. Jesus looks at him and says, just go and sell everything you've got. That wasn't in his script. That wasn't what this young man was wanting. His sense of security, his, you know, the pride of himself, I kept all the commandments, and his sense of security is in his money. He knows that he can afford what's going on around him. He knows that if he needs to get food, he can just go and get food. He doesn't have to think about it. If he were, if this was updated, if he were alive today, he's the guy that knows he can walk in and buy a car on a credit card and pay it off next week, possibly even just with cash in his pocket. You know, whip out the old wallet and there's £33,000, just pocket change, mate, pocket change. He is the rich man. His security is rooted in keeping the law and in being rich. And when he gets his sense of righteousness changed, he can't take it. He can't actually handle the truth. I don't actually believe Jesus is telling everybody to sell everything they've got. I'm not that convinced. It will apply to some of us. I don't think it applies to everybody. But what does apply to everybody is, are you willing to put aside your sense of security, the thing that keeps you proud of yourself, and do the right thing? The right thing for this young man was to go and get himself involved. It's not enough to have money. He needed to be getting involved with the poor around him. The right thing for us might be something slightly different. But Jesus will not want us to be sitting on the sidelines feeling proud about ourselves because we go to church every Sunday or, you know, we tick all the boxes. He wants us in the game. That change, the young man couldn't handle. But we need to be thinking about, well, we need to be acting out of love. Jesus acted out of love. We need to act out of love. That's our sense of righteousness. Second, I want to look at the woman at the well. And I'm aware that I seem to come back to this woman quite often. She's fab. She's just so simplistic in the sense of this is what she wants, and she just takes the answer. Now, I very often seem to come back to this woman. But again, picture the journey. Picture the moment. Think of the disciples' faces, because we're now into John chapter 4, verses 27 through 30, just that little bit. So John chapter 4, in the immediate predecessor, but you've got Jesus talking to this woman, and he's just blown her mind by describing her whole life and commenting about her husbands and her living conditions. And then 27, just then the disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, what do you want? Or why are you talking with her? Then leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? They came out of the town and made their way towards him. And a wee bit further down, verse 39, many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I ever did. Imagine our disciples, our 12 likely lads who have been walking around with Jesus. They've heard him teaching. They've seen him do things. They've popped into town to go and get lunch. You know, the Palestinian equivalent of Tesco sandwiches. And they've come back, and they find the boss chatting to a woman. And a Samaritan woman. And you can just imagine their faces just dropping. It's like, hang on, how many taboos can this man break in one morning? You know, he's a Jewish man talking alone to a Jewish woman. And she's not even Jewish, she's a Samaritan. Oh my goodness, I mean, it just, they must have had that sinking feeling. They must have begun to imagine, you know, we talk about now in modern media, we talk about the optics, how things look. One photograph there and the Sun would have had a week's worth of headlines. And yet they have the sense, because they know Jesus well enough by this time, not to say anything. And I love that, that no one asks, what do you want, pointing at the woman? No one asks, why are you talking with her to Jesus? They just keep stum and let them get on with it. It's a lovely little insight to life on the road with Jesus there. The disciples have worked this one out. This is a woman who goes to the well at midday because the other women don't want her. You don't go to the well at midday because it's the hottest part of the day. You go and fetch water, you do all the heavy lifting of water carrying in the morning or in the evening, not at midday. You know, mad dogs and Englishmen, etc., etc. This is a woman who is socially lonely. And Jesus is talking to her. In fact, he's just given her the conversation of her life. What is keeping her at this stage away from those women in the village? Well, yeah, they don't want to hear her. But you and I know how that works. Oh, well, they don't want to talk to me. Well, I'm not going to talk to them. And that pride kicks in. I was like, no, they've rejected me. I am not going to speak to them. I'll just go out at midday every day. And then that's done with it. Now, I'm reading a lot into her. But it's human nature to have that sort of, that pride, that negativity that says that, well, I'm not going to deal with them. And yet, what does she do once Jesus has spoken to her? She leaves her water, leaving her water jar, the entire purpose for being at the well, and heads straight back into town with the news, I've just met this guy, you've got to come listen to him. She put her pride aside. She found that her sense of security had shifted. Her security, her self-security was based on the idea, I'm alone, I don't talk to the people in the town. You can imagine, there must be people we know who have decided to live like this. They live on their own, they don't interact with people. And they've got to a stage where they're absolutely sure they're not going to act with people because, well, that would just mean that, you know, they might make friends. Can't do that. She walks home and she puts her pride to the side and she actually deals with these people and says, listen, my sense of security up until now has been in the fact I've been alone, but I can't do that anymore. I have to talk to you. I've had my sense of righteousness altered. She believed that you had to be perfect to meet God. That's the Samaritans were looking for God. They'd been told they weren't allowed to worship over there because that was for Jews only. Her sense of righteousness had been shifted. She realized that you had to meet Jesus first. And then you understood what was right and wrong. In her world, everything had just gone through 90 degrees. And because she put it all aside, because she went back to her town, many Samaritans believed. Many people listened to her and went, wow. Isn't that the woman that lives alone? Let's listen to her. And her faith journey began. And thirdly, I want to look at the chapter that's referred to as the good thief. So I'm in Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. So just that little passage there. Luke 23, 39. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise. Now, there is an awful lot written about this chap. Apparently he has a name, and apparently he had, you know, people can tell me what job he did. I go by what Scripture says. He was, he hung there. Crucifixion was reserved for non-Roman citizens and those who had committed murder, theft, slave rebellion, treason, or religious transgression. And I love that on the list next to treason comes religious transgression. It's like, my goodness, you did the wrong thing. We're going to crucify. It's brilliant. But we've got a non-Roman citizen who had committed some kind of major crime. And he understands that, this is his lot. He's done something. He's going to pay the price for it. And despite everything that's been read, I just want to focus on the words, because it's the words that I've got. That's what Scripture gives me. It doesn't give me, his mum's name or his address. It gives me his words. And that's what I want to focus. We are only getting what we deserve. There is no hint in this man of that misplaced self-pride. He knows who he is. He knows what he's done. And he knows this is what you get. He's not sitting there proclaiming his innocence. He's not, tweeting out complaints about people. He's just saying, yeah, we're only getting what we deserve. His pride isn't there. Not like the other guy. The other guy on the other side, full of anger, full of, no. Pride gone. At the end of it, he says, remember me. His sense of security is not in his actions or in his deeds in the past or in the people he knew or in the life he lived. Right at the end, his sense of security is in Jesus, the man on the cross next to him. And it's to him he says, remember me. He's not talking to the Roman soldiers down there going, remember me, I'm chatting to Jesus. You'll write that. No. He's talking to Jesus directly as best he can in the pain and the agony he is in and saying, remember me. He is putting his sense of security into Jesus. And he understands where righteousness lies. He points out this traitorous, slave rebelling, murderous thief. Understands exactly where righteousness lies. Righteousness lies in Jesus. And his faith journey, three breaths long, starts with that recognition. He has done nothing wrong. I've done it wrong. He hasn't. And my sense of security is entirely in Jesus. Three ordinary people. A convicted criminal, a social outcast, and a man with a lot of cash. But it's when they encounter the actual person of Jesus, not the religious people, not the people who are living a good life because of their religion, but Jesus himself, that their beliefs are challenged and altered. They couldn't have done it on their own. They couldn't have got round it. The rich man needed to free himself from his ideas of what was secure, his wealth. And he needed to take that in and become active in the kingdom, because the kingdom of God is here. It's not something that is going to come at some distant point. The kingdom of God, Jesus said, is here. It is now. So he needed to get active. He needed to lose the sense of security in his money, put his pride out away from him, and just get on with it. The woman in the well, more than anyone, needed to get round the pride and the hurt that she felt and go and talk to people. Maybe even people that didn't necessarily like her. There'll have been some people in that village who didn't even know that there was a feud going on. Say, why do you live on your own? It's an old story. She put her pride away. And the thief on the cross needed to understand where true righteousness lies. It lies in the person of Jesus. Each of these had to meet Jesus directly. Now, for myself and for a few others here, tomorrow represents the start of the new school year. The old has gone, the new has come. And so my challenge is to us all, including myself, to have a fresh start to our faith journey. Do we recognize in ourselves one of these traits? Are we getting a little bit too proud of what we are doing to stop looking at what Jesus would do? Are we getting a little too secure in the life we have to stop focusing on Jesus and to be talking about Jesus? Are we losing our direction in terms of righteousness and making stuff up or borrowing stuff from other places rather than seeing, what does Jesus say? Our pride, our sense of security, and our understanding of righteousness. Carl Medeiros, who is an author and an expert in Christian-Muslim relations, said something about the gospel in his writings, and I'm going to finish with this. As a Christian teacher, he put it all together and said, the gospel is not an idea. It's not a belief. It's not your favorite verse. The gospel doesn't live in your church. It cannot be written down in a simple message, and it's not the sinner's prayer. The gospel is not a what. It is not a how. The gospel is a who. The gospel is literally the good news of Jesus. Jesus is the gospel. And everything we do as we look to a fresh start has to come rooted in him. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you that we can listen. And we ask that by your Spirit, you would show us what we need to do. What we need to do to carry out your kingdom plans in our corner of the world this week. Do we need to lay pride away? Do we need to check what our security is in? Do we need to realign our sense of righteousness and come and meet with you again, afresh, to hear you in the words of your Son Jesus, in the actions of your Son Jesus, so that the people around us that we've been hearing about and all week through the evangelism conference will not see Buckie Baptist Church. They won't see us as individuals with our own ideas. They will see Jesus. The love, the forgiveness, and the sheer awesomeness of the man, your Son. And through that, they will find their lives changed. Help us to have that new start with you this week. For we ask this in your name. Amen.